Welcome to Park Street Christian Church as we celebrate Earth Sunday.
Hi, my name is Ruth and I will be your liturgist today. Please join me in reading responsibly our call to worship. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Though we find ourselves isolated in homes, apartments, and residential places, yet we would listen to the birds singing, reminding us that the whole creation rejoices in the love of our God. Though we cannot reach out and touch our friends and neighbors, we would rejoice that Jesus is in our midst, holding out hands of grace and hope to us. Though we have to stand at a safe distance from others, whispering hello through masks, we know that the Spirit is all around us, breathing peace on us in these moments, surrounding us with grace and hope. Now let's join Donna in singing our opening hymn, Well Suited for Earth Sunday, All Creatures of Our God and King. Today, Pastor Colleen will be joined by Brian Day as they both consider not only the beauty and power of God's creation, but the interdependence and necessity of all creatures of our God and our King.
So as I sit on the front stoop and the wind's blowing and trees are really responding to the wind, you can hear it probably. The birds are chirping, and there's no denying that nature is all around. As much as we try to plow it under and erect houses, because in the distance I can hear all the cars driving by and the guy that is building housing developments all around our property. I can hear the bulldozers in the background. It's a maybe fortuitous intro to Earth Sunday and why taking care of God's planet is so important. Turning to scripture seems to help. So maybe you could read responsively with me Psalm 19.
Psalm 19 and Reflections. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims God's handiwork. Look to the mountains and see everlastingness. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. Search both day and night and watch for the glory of it. There is no speech, nor are there words. Their voice is not heard. Listen to the silence and hear wonder speak. Yet their voice goes out through all the earth and their words to the end of the world. Look to the horizon to hear a word about eternity. In the heavens, God has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a beloved from a wedding canopy, and like a strong athlete runs its course with joy. Look to the sunrise and enjoy God's forever promise. Its rising is from the end of the heavens and its circuit to the end of them, and nothing is hid from its heat. Look to the seasons and live God's rhythm. The law of God is perfect, reviving the soul. That decrees of God are sure, making wise the simple. Look to creation's order and accept its wisdom. The precepts of God are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of God is clear, enlightening the eyes. Look to justice and truth and feel their light. The fear of God is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of God are true and righteous altogether. Look to the word and recognize its call. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb. Look to God's commandments and taste their sweetness. Moreover, by them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Look to creation's order and know justice. But who can detect their errors? Clear me from hidden faults. Look to grace and know its forgiveness. Keep back your servant also from the insolent. Do not let them have dominion over me. Look to what brings life and live its example. Then I shall be blameless and innocent of great transgression. Look to God's covenant and know its love. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O God, my rock and my redeemer. The heavens are telling the glory of God.
So, you know, I've been milling and mowing around Daisy Hill Farm for the past several weeks, and there's a good reason for that. It's spring and the grass is growing, and I actually like to mow. And so I really have these fantastic views of the mountains around here And it's not hard to actually think about God and nature when you listen to the trees and the wind and when you see this incredible backdrop of mountains. And I think about different scriptures, and one is Psalm 19. Look to the sunrise and enjoy God's forever promise. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and nothing is hid from its heat. Look to the seasons and live God's rhythm. The law of God is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of God are sure, making wise the simple. Look to creation's order and accept its wisdom. Look to the seasons. Pay attention to nature. Listen, look, sense God's rhythm. So you can learn a whole lot if you pay attention. Attention to things that history's farmers and hunters and gatherers and planters and planners have paid attention to. If you pay attention to what nature is telling you, if you pay attention to the seasons, I still love the Farmer's Almanac because it advises me about what the current trends are in weather. Seasons come and seasons go. A great scripture I know that you're familiar with comes from Ecclesiastes 3. So it's written in verse 1, and then I'm going to like hop through to verse 11. It says, there is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. Oh, don't we know? And then from verse 11, the Creator has made everything beautiful in its time. The Lord has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. So, in Zone 7, we plant our potatoes at St. Patty's Day, like the middle of March. And then there are other things that we can plant. Like, come over here and look at the garden here with me. I mean, we can plant onion sets, and we can plant sorrels coming up. It came up. Cabbage, it's so cool. We've got all sorts of stuff coming up here. Asparagus, radishes, tons of cabbage, it's so cool. There's a season that you can plant these winter crops. They're called winter crops. And then I talked about rhubarb. So follow me over here. I want you to look at the rhubarb patch. So last week I took a really pretty picture here, but now you can see something's going on. Because I didn't harvest it quickly, it's called bolting. See, I'm going to revolt against the bolt. I'm going to yank that off and throw it on the ground and hope that I can keep my rhubarb growing a little bit longer so I can harvest it. See, that's a thing. That's a thing in Zone 7. So there's some things that you shouldn't plant too early. All right? It doesn't matter how much you want a head start on the season. You can't force nature. I mean, so there's a time that you plant summer crops. One of those signs are when the peonies bloom. So look, here are peonies. They keep their jackets on. Look at this. They're keeping their jackets on. It's not ready for them to bloom. Do you know when it's going to bloom? Around Mother's Day. And Mother's Day is when it's the perfect time in Zone 7 to plant your crops. Your summer crops, that is. Okay? So, I know this. Most people who claim to be gardeners know this. So why do we get wooed by marketing? We do. We end up going to the hardware store, to even the garden center, who are the experts, and they start unveiling summer crops when it's not summer crop season. So I keep thinking this year, I'm going to just do a test. I'm going to test Mother Nature. I think I'm going to buy some of those summer crops and I'm going to put them in the ground and I'm going to get a head start. No. There's a price that we pay. Come on, back here. I'll talk to you about it. All right, so I'm bringing you over to a tragic site. It's me listening to marketers who want my money rather than to Mother Nature and like the rules of gardening, which is you do not put your tomato plants in the ground until after Mother's Day. That's in May for those of you who don't know. Come over here and you'll see the tragedy. It's not a Greek tragedy. It's a Daisy Hill tragedy. I want you to take a look at the most pathetic thing you've ever seen. This is a frost-bitten tomato. Sure, I could have come out here and put a bucket over it, but did I? No, because I didn't deserve these tomatoes to grow. Poor little tomatoes. I knew better than to plant those tomatoes. I mean, I knew better. Paul definitely knew better. He kept telling me, don't buy them. Even the guy at the garden center, who's my friend, was going, you know better. And I still bought them. It was silliness, really. Not paying attention to the cycles and the seasons. I know better than that. I mean, why is it that we ignore nature and everything nature has taught us? I mean, for thousands of years. We just keep thinking we know better, and we force our hands, and inevitably our hand gets slapped. So during this COVIDical, there I go again, climate that we're in, I mean, there's some questions I think all of us have been having, and I know I've had a lot of people talk to me about them, and I've had them. It's like, okay, what is God or nature or creation trying to teach us? What lesson can we learn in this crazy time? You know, I think it's pretty clear if we listen. And it's, if you abuse it, you lose it. If you abuse it, you lose it. I mean, if we could just stop and just pay attention and listen to the birds and listen to the trees and look at the trees and look at our plants, listen to the oceans, listen to our own bodies, our health, I think it's pretty clear that we need to make some changes. And it seems to be a pretty good time to be talking about this, not just because of COVID-19, but because it's Earth Day, and we're creatures of this earth, this planet that God created. Now, I could ramble, and I often do, over time, way too much time, but I gotta tell you, I really have to get back to mowing before the grass covers up my windows, and I have this really good friend. He's a wise friend, and he's also a super valued member of Park Street Christian Church. His name's Brian Day. And I asked him to share a little bit more about Earth Day and about taking care of God's planet. Have a listen. I'm going to hop on my mower. Bye.
50 years ago, for Earth Day, a 16-year-old high school student nerd went to pre-Earth Day sessions and recruited some of their speakers for a teach-in at his high school. When he was done, he met with his principal with a detailed all-day plan for all 1,200 students. The principal was taken aback and said, "Brian Day, why did you not talk to me about this first?" I responded to him saying, "You would have said no." We met the next day, and he said, "You were right. I would have said no." But then he asked three questions and then said yes. It was the beginning of my 50-year environmental career. Earth Day, the first, 50 years ago on the 22nd, this Wednesday, brought with it the creation of our Environmental Protection Agency, the passing of laws over the next few years, Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, and a slew of others. National media that night basically only covered a few demonstrations. They did not see that this was a call, mainly from the youth, for a values and based fundamental change in the world and how we do things. The moral part of this movement comes from our spiritual teaching in all faiths worldwide, but I will help you see it from the Christian Bible. In Leviticus, God states, "You shall not defile the land in which you live, in which I also dwell." God made the earth. We do not own it. They simply manage it for future generations. The creation story tells us we are to be stewards of the land. God made no junk. Natural systems completely recycle. Christian stewardship of the land does not end at the curb or the flush handle. There is no away. Everything we dispose of is still a part of God's holy creation. If you want to recycle, you must complete the loop, buying things made of recycled materials, Most toilet paper, now hoarded, is made completely from newly harvested trees. Yet there is lots of fully functional toilet paper made completely from recycled paper. That styrofoam takeout plastic straw has a 500-year life expectancy after one short use. But the microbeads that it breaks down into continue to contaminate the soil, water, and marine organisms for much longer than that. We use over 182 billion straws a year. If we are going to be stewards of this God-given planet, we need to change our behaviors for climate change, for our air, water, and enough food for all people to eat. Earth Day has taught us for 50 years that individual actions lead and new policy and corporate action follow. Please be a good Earth steward and don't wait.
A lot to consider as we share in the prayer for the people and together pray the Lord's Prayer. Though our lives seem so lonely and empty these days, yet there is sun in the morning, the moon and stars at night, the wonder of creation unfolding before our eyes and hearts, reminding us that we have nothing apart from you, God of Easter. When we need to maintain boundaries and safe distancing, when we realize how much we miss human touch, yes, even the introverts, you invite us to touch your loneliness with our own, your sorrows and scars with our own, brother of our souls. When we find ourselves huddling in locked rooms of our hearts, the doors and shutters of our souls securing us from the fears that are outside, you come, Spirit of Hope, to breathe peace upon us, to always surround us with hope, to never abandon us to our loneliness. Especially be with those whose names we lift now in this time of silence. God in community, holy in one, remind us we are never, ever apart from you. Even as we pray as we are taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Communion is central to the worship experience of the disciples of Christ. Weekly, we gather and invite all present to join round and participate at the welcome table, where all means all. At this time, you may want to pause this video and find elements that will suit in symbolism of the vine and the loaf, be it a grape, juice, or wine, be it wafer or bread.
And we remember that on the night he was handed over, while at supper with his friends, he gave us a pledge of love that does away with death. He took bread, gave thanks for it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, all of you. This is my body surrendered for you." And when the supper was over, he took a cup filled with wine, gave thanks for it, and shared it with them, saying, "Take and drink, all of you. This is the seal of a new covenant, my poured out life. I will drink this cup with you again at the table of God's joy in the new day that is coming. Whenever you do these things, remember me."
As you take communion on this day, remember the bread of life for all who hunger, the cup of compassion for a broken world. Amen.
They paid paradise, put up a parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique, and a swinging hot spot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. They took all the trees, put them in a tree museum. And they charged all the people a dollar and a half just to see them. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. Hey, farmer, farmer, put away that DDT now. Get me spots on my apples, will leave me the birds and the bees. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone? They pave paradise, put up a parking lot. Late last night, heard the screen door slam, and a big yellow taxi took it all away. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot.
That was our very own Sarah Woodward sharing song and watercolor. Sarah has grown in gifts and talents right here in front of her PSCC family, who bubbles with pride and appreciation. Now, as we begin to close our time of worship together, please join me in our benediction. May we always walk gently upon the earth in right relationship, nurtured by your love, open to the wind of the Spirit, taking only what we need, always open to the needs of others, making choices that bring well-being, living with generosity, striving for justice, honoring all with reverence, reconciling and peacemaking, mindful of those who will come after, recognizing our proper place as part of your creation. Grant us the strength and courage, Lord, or such a radical transformation into your kingdom. Amen. And now some closing considerations for your reflection and a special Earth Day video.
Well, as we come to a close of our worship service, I really want to take time to thank everybody who's helped PSCC keep their ministry going by being generous with their time and their dime. A special thanks, especially this week, to worship leader Donna Kane, who provided much of our music, and to Ruth Burdett, who served as our liturgist. A big shout out to both Sarah Woodward, who has contributed great Joni Mitchell music and her own Sarah Woodward artwork, as well as Brian Day for his wisdom and encouragement to all of us to be better stewards of God's creation and kingdom. For those of you who'd like to find ways to support our ministries, you can do so by these items there on the screen, Givelify, and also donations received at our address that's posted right here. And now, just for a special gift and thank you from Park Street Christian Church and those of us that live on Daisy Hill Farm, here's to a happy, healthy, and lovely Earth Day.
Yesterday a child came out to wander, caught a dragonfly inside a jar. Fearful when the sky was full of thunder, and tearful at the falling of a star. Then the child moved
And the seasons, they go round and round, and the painted ponies go up and down. We're captive on the carousel of time. We can't return, we can only look behind from where we circle again. 16 springs and 16 summers gone now. Cartwheels turn to cartwheels through the town. And they tell him, take your time, it won't be long. The circles turn, and the seasons, they go round and round, and the painted ponies go up and down. We're captive on the carousel of time. We can't return, we can only look behind from where we. And the seasons, they go round and round, and the painted ponies go up and down. We're captive on this carousel of time. We can't return, we can only look behind from where we came and go round and round and round in a circle again. So the years spin by, now the boy is 20. Though his dreams have lost some grandeur coming true, there'll be new dreams, maybe better dreams and plenty before the last revolving year is through. And the seasons, they go round and round, and the painted ponies go up and down. We're captive on this carousel of time. We can't return, we can only look behind from where we came and go round and round and round in the circle again. And the seasons, they go round and round, and the painted ponies go up and down. We're captive on this carousel of time. We can't return, we can only look behind from where we. Round and round in the circle again. We can't return.